Well, good morning, Soundside Church, and Pastor Aaron here, and thank you so much for tuning in this morning, whether you're watching on Facebook or YouTube. Of course, always a reminder to go ahead and click the subscribe button or the share button or the follow button or the like button or just one of those buttons that tells us you're watching and helps other people find us. So this morning, we're going to be in John chapter 6. We're also going to be in 1 Corinthians 10 and 1 Corinthians 11. And unlike some messages recently, we're going to ask you to really kind of get that Bible out there and dig in. We want you to see some of these things on the pages of Scripture today. Well, in 2016, Netflix released its first season of its original series, The Crown. This semi-fictional, semi-historical drama is about the reign of Queen Elizabeth II. Now, real quick caveat here. For the most part, the show is pretty tame, but because of a few episodes, it is rated for mature audiences. So please do not take my comments here as any sort of personal endorsement, okay? However, in one episode in the first season, we watch as Elizabeth's family prepares for her coronation. Her uncle, the Duke of Windsor, is not permitted to attend the coronation because he actually abdicated the throne. And so he is left to watch the coronation at home on television with a house full of guests. And as the coronation proceeds, he begins to narrate to his guests, explaining all the symbolism behind the ceremony. When the archbishop approaches the queen to anoint her with oil, four knights step forward with a canopy to hide her from view. The duke explains to his guests, "This is the most holy, the most solemn, the most sacred moment of the entire service." And one of the guests asks, "Well, why can't we see it then?" And the duke replies, "Because we are mortal." Later on, he explains, he says these words, he says, "Oils and oaths, orbs and scepters, an unfathomable web of mystery and liturgy." His guest replies to him, "That's just crazy." And the duke says, no, it's perfectly sane. Who wants transparency when you can have magic? Who wants prose when you can have poetry? Pull away the veil and all you have is an ordinary girl. But dress her up like this, anoint her with oil, and what do you have? A goddess. You know, for Americans, the whole concept of a monarchy seems ludicrous, and we can almost make fun of all the crazy costumes that so many of the British royalty wear in various ceremonial occasions. The rigid beef-eater guards, the weird customs like never turning one's back to the queen. But for at least some British citizens, the trappings, all the symbols, and the crown itself speak to something higher, something transcendent, something spiritual. You know, it's not a joke. It inspires awe, and it reminds each citizen that they are a part of a great chain of being that extends from heaven down to earth. We have nothing like this. Our country emerged out of a revolution that wanted nothing to do with kings and queens or nobles of any kind. We founded our country in an enlightened age of reason and science, not of tradition or symbols or ceremony. The closest thing we have is an eagle or a flag or an anthem. In fact, the custom of standing for the national anthem originated right here in Tacoma in 1893. And it was introduced at the beginning of sporting events as a way of bringing people together who ordinarily would be on two opposing sides. Although, as we've seen, even that custom is being changed in recent days. Now, don't get distracted, please. Don't get distracted by the national anthem thing. Focus. Focus for just a second, okay? The point is that if nothing else, symbols and traditions hold a culture together. And perhaps that partly explains why ours is falling apart. We have destroyed or defiled anything that might have brought us together, and some of the only things left that we still have in common are things that we hate. Taxes, elections, road construction. But if our country is losing its cohesion because we have abandoned the rituals or the symbols that help bind us together, what can we say of the church? Surely the church is a place of many symbols and tradition, and as we saw last week, there are a lot of quote-unquote churchy things that might be important rituals for Christians, but to those outside the church are merely riddles. Unfortunately, as we also saw last week, even in the church, Christians can disagree and even fragment over how some of these rituals are to be performed and even what the rituals themselves mean. But what if there were a ritual that was specifically designed to help keep the church together, to help preserve the church's unity, to pull us together and remind us of who we really are? What if there was a ritual that wasn't just an empty ceremony, but actually held the power to strengthen our faith, build our relationships, and brighten our light in a darkened world? There is, actually. And today we're going to look at what the Bible teaches about it. Today we're dealing with part two of our short two-part series, Riddles and Rituals. And just as we considered baptism last week, this week we are going to consider that ritual called the Lord's Supper, or as many of us call it, communion. You know, both baptism and communion have been called, quote-unquote, ordinances of the church because Jesus commanded them. But they are also referred to in some churches as sacraments. Now, what is a sacrament? In the words of Church Father Augustine, a sacrament is a visible sign of an invisible reality. They are gifts of God designed to present spiritual truths to our physical senses. We obey Christ by observing them, and in that sense they are ordinances. But in them, God Himself presents the gospel to our senses, to us. In baptism, we discover that we are united with Christ in His death and His resurrection. But what is communion? What is it all about? What does it do? Well, our story begins all the way back in the book of Exodus. Now, just as last week we looked at the how, the who, and the why of baptism, today we're going to reverse the order and we're going to look at the why, then the who, then the how. Well, Exodus chapter 14 begins helping us answer the question. Exodus 14 tells the story of the Passover. If you remember your Bible stories, you'll remember that the Israelites were originally slaves in the nation of Egypt. The Egyptian Empire had enslaved these people, and God was going to release them. He sent Moses, chose Moses to lead his people out of slavery, out of Egypt to himself, and part of the process involved bringing 10 plagues, God's signs and wonders on the nation of Egypt. Moses would go to Pharaoh and say, God says, let my people go. And Pharaoh would say, no, and God would drop a plague on Egypt. And Pharaoh might get a little irritated and say, well, maybe I'll let your people go. And then Moses would say, okay, we're going. And Pharaoh would say, nope, halt, you can't go. Moses says, God said, let my people go. Pharaoh's like, nope, God drops another plague. Well, there were a total of 10 plagues. And this isn't a message on Exodus or that passage of Exodus. This is about the Passover. So we get to the 10th plague, and the 10th plague is the death angel, and it's the worst of the 10. And God announces, he announces beforehand, there's an ample warning given that on a particular night, God is going to visit the land of Egypt, and he is going to kill the firstborn in every house. Now, this goes back to the fact where God said to Pharaoh, Israel is my firstborn. If you don't let him go, I will take your firstborn. There was ample warning. This was a final judgment that was coming. But God says, on this particular night, I will visit the land of Egypt and I will kill the firstborn in every house. But, if you want to escape this, let every house take a lamb or a goat for itself. Kill the lamb or the goat that evening. Take the blood and paint it over your doorpost and on the side of your doors. And that night, you're going to have a meal. You're going to eat the meat that you slaughtered. You're going to eat unleavened bread. You're going to eat bitter herbs. You're going to eat with your staff in your hand and your shoes on your feet. You're going to eat because you're going to get ready to travel, because that night, I'm going to let you go. I'm going to come visit the land, bringing my judgment, but when I see the blood on your door, I will pass over your house. And so that came to be known as the Passover. And God told his people that this will be the beginning of your annual calendar. This is how you're going to start. You're going to remember the Passover. And every year, you're going to celebrate the Passover meal as a remembrance of the night that I delivered you from slavery to Egypt. The Passover. And God's people, the Jews, celebrated the Passover annually throughout their history. There were certainly periods of time when they forgot to do it or were rebelling against God and didn't do it, but in general, it was a repeated annual celebration to remember the time that God delivered his people from slavery. And it always involved that blood of the lamb, because when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Well, the Passover meal, that annual celebration, that meal was the meal that Jesus Christ and his apostles were observing the night before Jesus was crucified, when he did something very strange at that meal. Matthew, Mark, and Luke in our Bibles tell the same story. Luke chapter 22 is one place where we find the story, and Jesus is sitting down with his disciples to eat the Passover meal, and he says to them, "I have wanted to eat this Passover with you, because I will not eat it again until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God." That's interesting, because there Jesus is telling his disciples that not only does the Passover point backwards to something God did in the past, Passover also pointed forward to something that God would do in the future, something that had not yet been fulfilled. Passover was just a sign or a symbol of something that was going to happen. And then Jesus, he took the cup that they were drinking from and he handed it to his disciples, said, "Divide this amongst yourselves." And then while they were doing that, he took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples and he said, "This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And then he took that cup and he said, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." Matthew and Mark record other words that he said, but he made it clear that his blood would provide forgiveness of their sins. And the point of all this was that the blood of the Lamb was the point of the Passover. It was all about that blood. But that night, Jesus taught his disciples that it was actually his blood that was the point of all of it. That the Passover, although the blood of the Lamb was the point of the Passover pointed to the blood of Jesus. And he told them that they would remember his sacrifice by sharing bread and wine together after he had gone. But Matthew, Mark, and Luke aren't the only ones to tell this story. They're not the only ones to say something about this new custom. Another disciple, John, wrote his account of Jesus' life, teachings, death, and resurrection. And though John doesn't really record much of anything about Jesus' Last Supper, not in the way that Matthew, Mark, and Luke do, John does record something that the other gospel writers don't mention. And it is something that would have been in the disciples' mind as Jesus was speaking. As Jesus says, "This is my body given for you. This is my blood that is poured out for you." As he's saying that, there's something that they would have remembered, I think, and it's something that he taught them earlier, and it's something that John writes in John chapter 6, verses 51 through 58. And that's what we're going to read right now. Jesus said, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." This is what Jesus said. In this particular context, in John chapter 6, Jesus had just performed a great miracle. We call it the feeding of the 5,000, where Jesus fed well over 5,000 people with a couple of fish and 5 loaves of bread. Not big loaves, but little baguettes of bread. He fed over 5,000 people. It was a miracle. It really was. Well, the next day, those people came back to Jesus asking for another free lunch. And he explained to them that the miracle was just a sign. They said, "We just want more bread." He's like, "Don't worry about bread. You can eat all the bread you want and you'll still die." He said, "Instead, why don't you eat the bread of life, the bread of heaven, that if you eat that, you'll never die. You'll have eternal life." And begins this long discussion where Jesus explains, "I am the bread. I'm the bread of life. I'm the bread of heaven." And we get the discussion that we just read. Well, some people struggle over this because they're like, well, Aaron, when some people do communion, they think that the bread really actually becomes the flesh of Jesus and that the wine really becomes the blood of Jesus. Well, now hang on just a second. What Jesus said about eating his flesh and drinking his blood is clearly symbolic, okay? Verse 54, he says, whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Now, you could take that super literally, and it would be weird. Or you can understand this is symbolic because of what he had already said several verses earlier in verse 40. He says this, for this is the will of my Father, that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Do you see this? Jesus equates those who eat his flesh and drink his blood, okay, they have eternal life, I'll raise him up on the last day. That's the same group as those who look on the Son and believe in him. They have eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. Same group of people. Feeding on my flesh and drinking my blood is the same thing as looking on the Son and believing in him. However, verse 56 tells us this is not a one-time event. Okay, verse 56 says, whoever feeds on my flesh, continual action, and drinks my blood, continual action, abides in me. It's not a one-time thing. It is a continual thing. Just like our life in Christ is a continual life. It's not just a one-time event. Christians often talk about that one-time event when we become Christians, but the Bible says a lot more about our faith. The Bible tells us that our faith in Christ, if it is true and genuine, must persevere and continue. If it doesn't persevere and continue, it wasn't genuine. It wasn't the kind of faith that saves. But this makes sense, right? I mean, just as we eat real bread and drink real wine that sustains our physical life, we don't just eat one meal, okay? It's not a one-time meal that you just eat and you're just good forever. We continue to eat, we continue to drink. Jesus says in verse 55, my flesh is true food, my blood is true drink. So just as food and drink continually sustain your life, Jesus' flesh and blood continually sustain our eternal life, our spiritual life in him. It is a continual thing. Okay? So again, just as real food and drink continually sustain us, so Jesus' flesh and blood broken, poured out, given on the cross, continually sustains our faith, as Jesus said. He says, as the Father sent me, I live because of the Father. If you feed on me, you will live because of me. Now, you could stop there and say, now, Aaron, what are you saying? Are you saying that in communion, we are really eating the body and blood of Jesus? No, the body and blood of Jesus are with him in heaven. But yes, in a way, I mean, exactly the way that Jesus meant, okay? He meant that feeding on his flesh and blood or drawing from what his flesh and blood did for us. Now, here's what he says. He continues to talk and explain to his disciples because this is a really hard thing for people to understand. It was hard for them to understand. So Jesus finally concludes it over in verse 63 where he says, it is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is no help at all. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. So when we come to the communion table, we think about Jesus' flesh and blood. Okay, it's not the bread and the wine. All right, the flesh does nothing. It's the Spirit that gives life. And what does he say? The words that I have spoken to you, they are spirit. They are life. It's the words of the gospel message. And the gospel is that Jesus, the Son of God, died on the cross and rose again from the dead so that we could be forgiven of our sins and have eternal life in him. Those are the words. That's where life comes from. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation, not crackers, not bread, not wine, not juice. That doesn't have any power to save anybody. Only Jesus' flesh and blood have the power to save. So in a way, we have to remind ourselves that in John chapter 6, Jesus was discussing bread. He was the bread of the miracle of the loaves and the fishes, and he's turning it around and saying, I'm the bread of life. You need to believe and trust in me. And so in one sense, John 6 is not about communion. Jesus was not talking about communion in John 6, but communion is about John 6. Did you catch that? John 6 isn't about communion, but communion is about John 6. In communion, God is preaching the gospel to our senses, and it must be received by faith as the gospel. It's not the elements of communion that save, it's what they signify, and that brings us to the who question. The why that we've been discussing up until now, the why of communion, what does it mean? The why of communion is that we receive the gospel afresh as the power of God to sustain our Christian lives. What's the meaning of communion? We receive the gospel afresh as the power of God to sustain our Christian lives. Look, it's not that communion is required to be a Christian, okay? And communion is not required to stay a Christian. But there is more to communion than just commemorating Jesus. But didn't Jesus say, do this in remembrance of me? Yes, he did. He gave us a gift, a ritual, a ceremony, a sacrament that preaches the gospel to our senses. Every time we do it, it reminds us of Jesus. It reminds us of where our faith is anchored. We need to constantly be reminded of this. And when we are reminded, God himself is preaching the gospel to us in a multi-sensory fashion. Consider what the Apostle Paul writes about this. There's more than just a memorial going on when we participate in communion. And that word participates, a great word. Listen to what the Apostle Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 10 verse 16. He says, the cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a participation in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread. Consider the people of Israel. Are not those who eat the sacrifices participants in the altar? And he goes on to explain. Now, at this particular point, he's not really teaching on communion. He's using a common understanding of communion to make another point entirely. He'll teach on communion in the next chapter. But he does make a very important point, and that is when we drink from the cup in communion and when we eat the bread in communion, we are actually participating in what the blood and the bread did. What did it do? It did a lot of things. It forgave our sins, it gave us eternal life, and it also made us part of the body of Christ. I love that statement because there's one bread. We who are many are one body. We all partake of that one bread. We participate in the body and the blood of Christ when we partake of communion, and we do it together. And that answers the who. The why is receiving the gospel as God... receiving the gospel afresh is the power of God to sustain our Christian lives. The who, though, the who is supposed to be taking communion is the church. It's the church. It's the body of Christ. This is who is supposed to be taking communion, the church. And as we've said, the church is composed of people who believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, sacrificed for them, risen again to give them eternal life. That's who they are. Jesus said it very clearly. The flesh doesn't do anything. Those elements don't do anything. Okay, it's the Spirit that gives life, and the words I have spoken to you, they are Spirit and they are life. If you don't understand the words and you don't believe the words, the elements aren't going to do anything for you. Okay, this is only for people who have believed the gospel and are relying upon the gospel that the elements of communion are pointing them to. Can I say it very simply? Communion is only for believers. Now, at this point, we get a question. What about children? Should children be participating in communion? Now, I've had discussions with some brothers in Christ, some fellow pastors that I respect, I admire, I love, but there's some disagreement here on children. Now, here's the thing. Should children take communion? My answer is this. Yes, if they are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. But if they are believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, something else must be true about them. They must be baptized. They must be baptized. Now, I'm not out on a limb here. This is an extremely common belief. Even people who disagree with me on baptism would say that you got to be baptized in order to participate in communion. This was the teaching of the early church. It's the teaching of the modern church. And I think it's the implication and teaching of the Bible. Now, some people could say, well, Aaron, they understand communion. Why can't they take communion? If they understand communion, then they understand enough to be baptized. But no one should participate in communion who has not publicly identified with Christ's body. When we take the bread, we take the cup, we are participating in what Christ has done to sustain continually the life that we have in Jesus. Now, what sort of ordinance or sacrament or sign or symbol or ritual or ceremony did Christ give us to mark the beginning of that life? It was baptism. And if a person has not marked their beginning of life in Christ in the way that Christ himself ordained, that is through baptism, then they should not be taking communion. They should not be recognizing something that they haven't said is true by the way that Christ said to do it. I hope this is making sense, and I'm not saying this to embarrass anybody, but we do have strong, strong indication from the scriptures. We realize that Christ, in the Lord's Supper, in communion, took Passover and turned it into a church ritual. He changed the meanings, or at least he fulfilled the meanings. But the Bible was very, very clear on Passover that nobody who had not been marked out as a member of the believing community was allowed to participate in Passover. In the Old Testament, it was circumcision. Little grody for us to think about, but the Old Testament was extraordinarily clear. If a person had not been circumcised, they could not participate in Passover. And I guess what we're saying is it is important to recognize the body of Christ when celebrating communion, which is why we're stressing that if you're not part of the body of Christ, you shouldn't be taking communion. And that brings us to the how. That brings us to the how. How should we participate in communion? And the Apostle Paul gives us very clear instructions in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. I'm going to begin reading in verse 23. I'm going to go ahead and read in verse 17 because it gives us some context about what was going on. Here's what the Bible says. In the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part, for there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. When you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper you eat, for in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many of you are weak and ill, and some have died. But if we judged ourselves truly, we would not be judged. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are disciplined so that we may not be condemned along with the world. So then, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, let him eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not be for judgment." Look, when we ask how of communion, questions of bread and drink are really not that important. Like, what kind of bread should we have? I think it should be unleavened bread. It's a great symbol, okay? Probably should be grape juice, also a great symbol. Some people argue about should it be wine or unfermented. I really kind of think that's an irrelevant question. What matters most from Scripture is the manner in which we do it. Okay, so how do we do communion? We do it in a way that recognizes the body of Christ. Part of that means that we don't celebrate communion with people who aren't baptized. Now, like last week, some people believe they have been baptized. We may disagree about whether or not they have or haven't biblically been baptized, but they believe they are. They have identified with the body of Christ publicly. So we do this, we celebrate communion with those who have identified with the body of Christ. But that also means that there is no such thing as private communion. There's no such thing as private communion. It's a contradiction in terms. There's no communion if it's done privately, which is why we did not celebrate communion or observe communion during the COVID shutdown. Okay, there's no such thing as virtual communion. I know some churches and pastors did, and I don't sit in judgment on them. But from my understanding of Scripture, it does tend to contradict the meaning of communion if we participate in it scattered and divided. It's about coming together. The future may present some challenges to this, but there's no private communion, there's no virtual communion. We also learn here that it is important to search our hearts. Let a person examine themselves before participating, which gives us an opportunity of confessing sin to God before we celebrate our union with Him. And it also gives us an opportunity to reconcile our relationships with other believers. Jesus said, if you come to give your offering to God and you realize that somebody has something against you, you need to stop what you're doing, go be reconciled, and then come finish what you're doing for God. We shouldn't be taking communion if there is strife or relational barriers between us. It should be a true celebration of unity. You know, this is an embosser. I received it as a Christmas present a long, long time ago, and I didn't know what it was for. It sat on my shelf for a long time, and I thought, well, great, what is this? And then I started getting a lot of books, and people would ask to borrow it, and then I realized, hey, I've got a way of marking my books. And you could put the flyleaf in here and cramp down, and it actually embosses, and it says, The Library of Aaron Carpenter. All of a sudden, I knew what it was for, and I could use it and used it to great profit. I really enjoyed using it, actually. Communion is one of those things that many Christians, I think, don't really know what it's for. It's something we do it to remember Jesus, but is that all? No. I hope that as a result of this message, you can see that communion is about more than just a memorial. It's a participation in the body of Christ, and it's a participation in His death and resurrection. So my invitation to you today is this. Do you have communion with God? Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? We invite you to come, believe in Him, turn from your sin, and receive Him as your Lord and Savior. Use communion as an opportunity to draw closer to God. If you don't spend time confessing your sins to God normally, use communion as an opportunity to do that. Use communion as an opportunity to make sure that you have a good relationship with others in your local church. Use communion to celebrate the unity that you have with other Christians. When you take that cup and you take that piece of bread, look around and realize you are joined together with everybody else who's doing the same thing. And then finally, when you take communion, take that bread, crush it between your teeth, take that juice or that wine and sip it between your lips and realize that if you believe the gospel that those things are preaching to your senses, you are receiving the grace of God by faith. And that faith in Christ is what God uses to sustain you. Allow communion to be a gift from God to preach the gospel to your senses and remind you of your Savior who holds you and sustains you. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for your grace. Thank you for this gift. And I pray that we will participate of it knowingly and believingly, Lord, receiving your grace by faith. And Lord, I pray that you will promote unity in your church and let our testimony shine out the brighter. In Jesus' name, amen.
There's no limit.